Well, good day today. We are back into the video blog action. Just went to, took about 50 people up, to, including myself, up to Fresh Wind. Did Fresh Wind Youth Conference, still got my little pink bracelet on here just to represent. And it was really good, still getting over a little bit of a cold, just blew my nose for about 10 minutes. So like you needed to know that, but hey. We are still in the book of Romans, and we got about 7 chapters left, so we're going to get right into chapter 9. We just finished arguably one of the most potent, just powerful, promise-filled chapters in the entire Word of God. Romans chapter 8 is just amazing. And coming into chapter 9, oh, happy Easter, by the way. Hope you had a great time with family, friends. You know, the lost, the poor, and especially with the Lord celebrating the death, resurrection, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And so chapter 9, Paul, the writer of this epistle, this letter to the Roman people, he flips the script and he starts talking about something that is a very kind of, there's a lot of different theology, I guess is the right word, on Romans chapter 9. But it is in the Bible. It's an important section of scripture. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to read Romans 9, verses 1 to 15, very quickly. And I don't think I'm going to comment a lot on it, simply because this is one of the topics I don't feel like I have a lot of revelation on, so I'm not going to try to teach something I don't have a lot of revelation on, but I'll let the Word of God speak for itself. This is what I will say before I read this. There's a lot of people who you know, are praying for Israel. I'm praying for Israel too. I believe that Israel probably has some kind of end time, you know, last days involvement, but I'm not sure that it's any more so than Canada or the USA or Mexico or any country in Africa or Australia or England or, you know, the reality is that God loves Israel, but I don't believe that He loves Israel more than He loves Canada. I don't believe He loves a Jewish person more than He loves a Gentile. His love is a constant, and in Christ, the Bible says very clearly there is no Jew, no Gentile, no barbarian, no, there's no man, there's no woman, we are all one in Christ Jesus. Meaning, it doesn't mean we're a big blob of, you know, God pushes all of our entities together, become this one kind of, you know, like Borg, you know, unit or something like that, you know, from Star Trek, The Next Generation anyway. Don't bother with that, but we're going to be individual, but He loves us all the same. And we choose the measure that we love Him, but He's no respecter of persons. I don't believe that the Lord favors any person more than another. I mean, obviously the favor of God can rest on one more than another, but that's due to that person's faith, that's due to, you know, the working of the Lord in their lives. You know, there's a lot of factors, but the reality is that the Bible says very clearly, God is no respecter of persons, and God doesn't show partiality. And so, you know, I feel a lot of unhealthy, perhaps, focus on Israel. And I believe we should pray for Israel, but I believe that we should pray for every nation. And, you know, if God puts Israel into people's hearts, that's totally cool. But I think that sometimes I've seen it so off kilter, so off balance before, that people are so focused on Israel that they forget about the lost people around them in their neighborhood. And just, you know, I think that's a... I don't think that's the heart of God. I think that people can get off kilter there. So, just wanted to prelude the reading of this portion with that. Maybe I'll just, we'll see how far we get. This is what Paul says, chapter 9, verse 1. With Christ as my witness, I speak with utter truthfulness. My conscience and the Holy Spirit confirm it. Verse 2. My heart is filled with bitter sorrow and unending grief. Verse 3. For my people, the Jewish brothers and sisters. And in the Greek, it just says, it actually takes out sister. Paul just says, my Jewish brothers. But the New Living Translation, which we're reading out, always adds the female counterpart in there. So just to let you know that. I would be willing to be forever cursed, that's what Paul says, cut off from Christ, if that would save them. So he's admitting that these many of these Jewish people are not saved. They don't belong to Christ Jesus. Verse 4, they are the people of Israel, chosen to be God's adopted children. Chosen, the Greek actually says chosen for sonship. God revealed his glory to them. He's talking about the Old Testament, the covenants. He gets into it. He made covenants with them and gave them his law, the law of Moses. He gave them the privilege of worshiping him and receiving his wonderful promises. Verse 5, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are their ancestors, and Christ himself was an Israelite as far as his human nature is concerned. And he is God, he being Jesus, just said, and the one who rules over everything and is worshipped and is worthy of eternal praise. Amen. Verse 6, well then, has God failed to fulfill his promise to Israel? No, for not all who are born into this nation of Israel are truly members of God's people. So Paul's saying, just because you're born a Jew, just because you're born of the nation of Israel, does not mean you belong to God. Verse 7, being descendants of Abraham doesn't make them truly Abraham's children. For the scriptures say, Isaac is the son through whom your descendants will be counted. Though Abraham had other children too. We're going to actually stop there, and let me just touch on this verse. The Bible says, only those who are descendants of Isaac. And Isaac was the child of promise. He was the child that Abraham received by faith. And so, in order to be a child of God, we need to be children of faith. That's basically what Paul has been speaking all along, and what he's going to get more into is he's saying it doesn't matter what your ancestry is. Even John the Baptist said in the Gospels, he said, God can raise up children of Abraham from these stones. Because it's a matter of faith. It's a matter of the heart. It's a matter of what you are putting your trust and your hope and your faith in. And we can't put it in our ancestry. We can't put it in grandma's faith. We can't put it in anything else but in Jesus Christ. And so, you know, Abraham had tons of children, but only the ones that came through Isaac were the children of promise, and only the ones that came through Isaac, you know, were part of the nation of Israel. Everyone else didn't make it in. It was only Isaac's lineage, but Isaac was a child of promise. So if you want to be a child of faith, you need to receive the promise, Jesus Christ. That's basically what Paul's going to get into. It doesn't matter your natural ancestry. It matters that you receive his promise. You receive it by faith, Jesus Christ. We're getting into deep things. And I encourage you, you're going to need a lot more than this video blog to fully grasp the reality of what Paul is saying. So I encourage you to go deeper and continue to study the Word of God. Hopefully we've sparked something in you. It's a matter of faith. It's a matter of the heart. God bless you today, and we'll see you again tomorrow. Have a great day.